I'm an auditor with the Training Accreditation Council. I've been in that role for some time, but I've also run workshops on various topics, and I know I've come across many of you before, and I admire your bravery still being in the room. But thank you very much. The amount of training, our topic for today, is something that's been reasonably recently introduced into the standards. The concept has always been there, but it's now much more explicit in the standards. And that doesn't mean that there needs to be a more explicit response. And as a person who's spent a lot of time in the vet sector, amount of training is clearly an issue that needed to be addressed. And so it's good to have the opportunity to talk with you about that today. And looking at the list of participants, you are a wonderfully representative group of trainers and assessors, RTO managers, compliance managers, and other people involved in the development of quality delivery within the vet sector. So it's great to see you here. We're going to look at the amount of training, and as it's a relatively new idea that is woven into standards 1.1 and 1.2, we have to say the benefit of a glossary entry in the standards leaves a little bit unsaid. My role is to present a perspective on the amount of training, and I guess the part of the question is it's there, we have to address it, it needs to be something thought about. We need to think of it as a trigger for thinking about what we do as trainers and assessors and as RTOs in making sure that we provide sufficient training to enable people to achieve the standards and the outcomes that are planned. We need to think of it as a trigger for thought. And at the end of the day, as auditors, what we are keen to see is how you've thought about this issue. Not so much sort of actual numbers, although numbers can come into it, it's one way of looking at it, and it's the way that I'm going to suggest you look at it today. It's more that you've given thought to what sort of amount of training, what sort of attention to support the learner you've given to make sure that they can get from where they start to where they need to go in terms of competency standards. So we're going to think about how we should specify it, and it's important to reflect comments earlier that we're not here to, in this particular case, to lay down a particular set of rules, but to give you some ideas about ways you can not only deal with this idea, but also make it a useful idea. So we need to think about calculation of an amount of training. We might think about the sorts of things that will make the amount of training or necessarily more or less. And we need to think about whether we can change the amount of training, whether it's something that is locked down. And I think it's important for me to say right from the start that it is critical that you don't regard this as a kind of straitjacket, as a kind of a constraint. It actually is, as I said, more about being thoughtful about what you're providing to your learners. And that may mean that as you get to know your learners better and as you get to work with your resources more and as you focus more on industry engagement, you might discover that the amount of training that you thought was appropriate needs to be changed. And how do we use this amount of training, and what evidence will an auditor need to see? So we've got quite an agenda, and in support of that agenda, we have a set of transparencies that are, that's rather old-fashioned, isn't it, slides, PowerPoint slides, and you do have a copy of these, not all of them, because some of these are kind of developmental. When I was looking into this topic, I wanted a picture of a normal curve. So I Googled normal curves and I came up with this set. And I was rather intrigued because it actually illustrated an important point. And that is that under traditional uniform instruction, and everything in the boxes was there, I didn't put that in. Under uniform instruction, if you have variability in aptitude, you'll end up with variability in achievement. And that might be fine if we want to rank people, if we want to sort of identify who's top and who's bottom. That makes the assumption, of course, that we've taught them the right stuff. But that might be fine. But in the context of the vet sector, we need mastery. We need people to achieve actual standards. We're not looking for variability. We're looking for uniformity of outcome. So if we just provide uniform instruction, we're going to end up with because of the variability of our learners, we're going to end up with highly variable outcomes. If we have a look at the amount of training, we have to ask ourselves, well, we're dealing with competency-based training here. It's not supposed to be about time. It's not supposed to be about fixed inputs. And we can see from in the traditional context that if you have fixed inputs, you end up with variable outcomes. In the vet sector, we want fixed outcomes. We want everybody to achieve the national vocational standards. So that means we're going to have variable inputs. We're going to have to provide more support for those who might have language literacy and numeracy issues to deal with. And we might, in fact, provide less training for someone who's already experienced and is very close to the mark already. So under those sorts of circumstances, when we start thinking about amount of training, perhaps we should talk about amounts of training, because there are going to be different amounts of training that are appropriate to different kinds of client groups. And for that reason, you won't find an industry group or an auditor or anyone saying, this is the right amount of training. It's not there is no number that can be prescribed which says this is it. It's more about how did you get to the decisions that you made about the amount of training you're providing. Within the context of the standards and in fact the standard one context section itself, it says, and I know you can read, but I will read it because I think it's worth emphasising the points. The RTO's training and assessment strategies and practices must have regard to the amount of training required for the learner to gain competency specified in the relevant package or vet accredited course. So it's your regard to the amount of training that's needed. And the amount of training will vary depending on the existing skills and knowledge of the learner, the mode of delivery, and include any work placement arrangements. And one of the questions that was asked was, well, what about traineeships? And we could add to that, what about apprenticeships? And clearly, what happens in the workplace, in a traineeship or an apprenticeship, is part of training and therefore part of the amount of training. The question is whether it's structured. If the workplace is just a sort of place where they carry on with experiential stuff that isn't in a sense managed by you, then it isn't part of the amount of training. But if you monitor what's happening in the workplace, if you prescribe certain activities and experiences, if you get feedback from the workplace in relation to performance, and if that feedback is used to shape their activities in the workplace, then it does become part of the amount of training and it does become part of the program. So you have to. We're asking the question, really, what is it that you're managing as a set of learning experiences for the learners? And are you managing a sufficient package of learning for this particular cohort of learners to get to the objectives? So standard 1.3 basically talks about providing adequate resources generally. So it talks about sufficient trainers and assessors. It talks about education and support services. It talks about accessible learning resources and facilities and equipment. So 1.3 says, have you amassed the resources necessary to be able to provide the service you're promising to these learners? But 1.1 says, have you planned a program of learning, of structured, managed experiences which will enable the person to use these resources that you've gathered together to achieve their outcomes? And that's the critical the concept of the amount of training, is that it's your planning and your thinking to bring together the resources and experiences that will enable the person to get there. Why are we trying to deal with this? Well, one of the problems is there is a continual pressure to shrink course time. And that is because of commercial interests. You know, someone down the road is running the same course in half the time and charging less money. Maybe I better do the same. Well, that shrinkage might be considered improvements in productivity, but ultimately it'll reach the point where it begins to damage quality and credibility. And so we as auditors and the standards, most importantly, the auditors are not important, the standards are what matter here, are basically saying there's a limit to how far you can go. You're going to have to make sure the amount of training is sufficient, those key words, is sufficient to enable people to achieve the outcomes that you're promising. But we also have unreasonable learner expectations, and so you'll get circumstances where learners don't understand, for example, that it's more than just the contact time. So that in fact you're going to have perhaps some pre-reading that you are going to require of them, as it was asked of you for today, that there may be some follow-up reading, there will be maybe other activities in workplaces and experiential stuff that you will manage, so that it isn't just contact time, but it is contact time plus other aspects. And so we need to think about those extra aspects and then communicate it to the learners so they know this is the kind of time that they need to set aside in order to achieve the outcomes that you're promising in the delivery of the training. So we don't want learners to end up with a kind of shallow understanding of what's expected of them. Likewise, we have to be careful that amount of training doesn't become a mount of training, where it's a monstrous hill for them to climb because every year you've found something really beautiful and you've added it in and you've added it in and you've added it in, and the course gets bigger and bigger and grosser and more difficult for people to achieve. So it's also about you being careful in your planning to make sure that you don't set unreasonable demands on learners. So we need to think about flexibility. And quite often what happens is that people lock themselves in and say, this is how I deliver and the students have to adjust to me. This is how I do it, you change to fit me. Amount of learning is, or amount of training is basically saying, what we want to have here is an understanding that different learners have different needs and that we need to be flexible in order to be able to accommodate those different needs. So we're looking as auditors, and the standards are looking for your flexibility, and that's why it uses that actual word when it comes to the discussion in the standards themselves. Amount of training, though, is a phrase that is now added to one of many that we have in the vet sector. We need to ask ourselves what is it and how it contrasts with other standards. It was one of the questions, or many of the questions that were asked for this session related to this particular issue. I want to think about it as the amount of time, and the word time could be in hours, but it could be just a kind of feeling, if you like. But I like to think of it in terms of hours. It's sort of a measure you can work with. The amount of time a learner's mind is engaged in acquiring the units of a qualification or a skill set. It's the amount of braining, actually. It's the amount of time the mind is engaged. And this is different to other things like volume of learning. Volume of learning is an incredibly gross figure which talks about learning in terms of a sort of typical year of 1,200 hours. It takes into consideration hierarchies of learning, so a degree incorporates first and second years in talking about its volume of learning. In other words, it's a very gross estimate, and it doesn't tell you how much time the individual has to put into the learning. It just thought it's too rough. In actual fact, it's really there not so much for you to use, but for the developers of training packages and qualifications to use to make sure their qualification is of an AQF level. So it's not really a tool for you, and it never was really designed for you to work with. Whereas amount of training, which involves you giving thought to the learner's engagement with the learning, is much more, dare I say it, down to earth and something you can actually work with. The course duration doesn't tell you what commitments involved within the difference between the start time and the finish time. Course duration is just start time, finish time, and what happens inside that time is the amount of training. Nominal hours is really just for budgeting purposes and for calculating resources that are needed. And again, it may not include, it's more likely to be related to your commitment of staff to training, whereas all sorts of other activities which are structured, such as pre-reading and follow-up reading and so on, don't engage your staff, don't involve yourselves as deliverers, so it won't count in nominal hours. And finally, contact hours clearly is just the face-to-face bit, this bit. And it doesn't include the pre-reading bit that you did before you came here today. So contact hours, again, is just a very shallow picture. It doesn't tell the whole story. So we need to go beyond those, but you can see that those four other ideas can easily be mixed up with amount of training. And each of them has a role, but none of them actually talk about the kind of time, the kind of effort that the individual learner is putting in. And that, at the end of the day, is when the learning is happening. And so it'd be nice to bring that picture into the process. So it's worth adding a fifth idea, even though it can become a little confusing. So what you need to do is to start estimating the time that a typical learner's mind is wholly engaged on a set of learning activities or tasks that are managed and expected by you, the trainer and assessor. So it's not sort of voluntary stuff that a person might do. That's over and above the amount of training. The amount of training is where you as a trainer are making structured plans for a person to engage in activities such as reading a text and doing some comprehension questions or participating in the workplace and carrying out some observations or being observed in that workplace. So it can be seen in that sort of way. Whether you measure that time in hours or whatever, it doesn't matter. But the thing about it is, have you thought about that time? And have you made sure that there is sufficient engagement? Now, when I say typical learner, I mean, that's a difficult thing to pick on too. So we are going to have to remind ourselves that having identified what the typical learner is going to do, we recognise that there's going to be variations. So there'll be some who'll need more time, and others who will need less. And that's perfectly legitimate. But you've got to start somewhere, so start with the typical learner. It's a useful place to start. And if we do that, then we would hope that we can get some useful ideas out of that process. One is that we can describe the level of commitment that we expect of the learner. Secondly, we can help the learner to balance all the competing demands on their time. Maybe they will have to give up some part-time work so that they have enough time for your requirements. Or maybe they will have more time than they expected. It enables the learner to make a realistic appraisal of the commitment they're making when they contract to do training with you. I know it's a frustration for a lot of trainers that students do quite often think that all they're asked to do is attend class and somehow or other, within that limited time, all will be achieved. So it involves making sure that you're not being too harsh and setting too onerous requirements or being too lenient and saying, oh, well, look, we'll just, you know, it'll just get through. If they don't make it, it's their fault. You need to make sure that you are putting in the commitment through your own activities and through activities you require of the learners so that they will be able to achieve the standards that they're striving towards. It also helps you understand the impact of alternative modes. So, for example, there might be new technologies coming along and you can reasonably ask the question, is this going to affect the amount of training? Will I be able to achieve more in less time? And sometimes new technologies have the reverse effect. They might enhance quality but take more time. So fundamentally what you are able to do is to use the amount of training as a kind of rubric for and analysing alternative modes, including things like online learning and face-to-face learning and workplace learning and any other kinds of new technologies or approaches that you might want to explore. It also helps you to and focus on the learner needs. Quite often you see in a training and assessment strategy, these are my learners, but very rarely do you really see an analysis, and because I've got this variability in my learners, this is what's going to mean for my training. So the training and assessment strategy document often declares variation and then doesn't respond to it. And the amounts of training help to encourage you to think, well, how am I going to respond to these variations? Now, of course, you can respond by making your group of students more uniform by applying some form of entry requirements. I will only take people who have done the Certificate 3, for example, in which case you've narrowed the cohort's variability and your amount of training will be much simpler. But if you're an organisation that wants to serve a broader range of interests and a broader range of clients, then we would need to see in your training and assessment strategies through your amounts of training that you had in fact taken into consideration what that, the impact of that would have on the sort of engagement of learners so that they could achieve the outcomes. And through all of that, we get a sense of the credibility of the delivery that you're offering. That what you're offering is a delivery which hasn't been pruned to the point of some of my roses to the point where they die, but actually pruned to produce more, to be better, so that the training is sustained, the quality and credibility of training is sustained. So I could ask you the question, if we were looking at a course of training, what sort of things might mean that there was more training required? What sort of things might mean that more training is required? Minimal skill, previous skills, training and experience. That would mean that you would need to maybe put into place some sort of literacy and numeracy programs. You may need to provide more time for reading. You might need to provide additional support within the organisation, such as coaching and mentoring. And that would increase the amount of training. What sort of things might reduce the amount of training necessary? Okay, so the comment was having prerequisite quals or having previous skills and experience. And under those circumstances, you would be looking at either a fast-track program or you might even be looking at RPL. RPL is not zero when it comes to amount of training because there's still going to be an engagement of the person in the process of acquiring the outcomes. But it's going to be much less. So that you can see that there are sorts of things. The complexity, there is a little list of things that we'd come up with from our thinking about this. The complexity of the units of competency. Some units of competency are quite simple to explain and to develop, and others are complex and difficult to achieve. That's going to take more effort on your part and, most importantly, more effort on the part of the learner. Industry requirements. Industry itself can lay down requirements in terms of participation in the workplace or amounts of time engaged in particular activities in the workshop or modes of delivery. There are some modes of delivery which involve less of your time but more of their time. Or assessment strategies. Some assessment strategies are very time consuming. Other assessment strategies will be very slick and quick. Learner characteristics has already been mentioned as a key issue. Clustering of units can reduce the overall amount of time that is spent on training. In other words, one of the reasons we cluster is quite often because of the overlap of units means that we can, in fact, deal with units in less than taken together in less time as required if they were taken apart. Also, though, for that matter, clustering by function is useful too because quite often that streamlines the thought processes and the learning of the learner as well. So clustering can have an impact in terms of amount of training and just simply the number of units. And for that matter, a person who comes to you with units already achieved is going to require a smaller amount of training than to achieve a qualification than a person who has to go through the whole lot or including prerequisite units. So again, you're going to get tremendous variations in the amount of training. And what we will be looking for in the training and assessment document is an acknowledgement of that kind of thing and how you're going to cope with it. Yes?
Is it valid to talk about pre-existing life skills influencing or varying the amount of training? So for example, if we think about people working in direct patient care type roles. When somebody learns how to make a bed the way we want them to for that role, it's not that dissimilar to making your own bed. Whereas in some cultures, they don't know how to make a cup of tea for somebody, and so they've got to start from scratch. On the other hand, that's a great deal of difference between those sort of examples and basically showing anybody how to use a hydraulic hoist for the first time.
But you see, if I may say, you're doing the thinking straight away. And that's exactly the thinking we're asking to see, that you're asking the question, will those life experiences enable me to take into consideration ways of streamlining what I deliver? Or will, say, cultural differences, as you've suggested, mean that, in fact, this particular cohort will require extra effort and extra time in order to get the cultural components that are intrinsic within the standards to under their belt? And I guess that's exactly the kind of thinking. So the answer is, from my perspective anyway, is yes, that sort of thinking is exactly the sort of thinking we're looking for. So that you might say in your training and assessment strategy document, some of our clients are people from overseas who come from other cultures. The question is, well, I mean, in some circumstances that will have no impact on the amount of training because they are literate and numerate and already. It's not a question of that. But there might be other issues which will mean that it's going to take them longer to assimilate the requirements that we have within the context of the standards. Under those circumstances, it would be useful for you to make that comment within the training and assessment strategy, not just so that an auditor can see that you've given it that thought, but so that a trainer and assessor picking it up will say, well, I've got people with those sorts of backgrounds in my class. I'm going to need to devote some time to supporting them so that they can to make these shifts. So it's exactly the kind of thinking that's needed. It's really good. Thank you. So we need to think about how we're going to calculate the amount of training. And I use the word calculate because it sounds kind of numerical, and I suppose we could use the word estimated, determined, whatever word you like. But one way in which this could be done would be to estimate time involved in things like formal contact, face-to-face classrooms, prescribed preparation, and prescribed follow-up. Notice the word prescribed, which means that you are expecting the learners to do these things. It's not just the time that they might spend on the web exploring the topics voluntarily. It's where you've said, I want you to go to the web and I want you to follow up these ideas, and where you've been precise about that. It's about time in the workshop or the laboratory, time in a workplace where they're doing structured experience. Not just immersion in the workplace, but where they have an agenda. That is, that they are looking for specific things, they are following down particular kinds of ideas, they are being observed and managed in the workplace. So I'll sometimes see apprenticeships where, you know, the workplace is kind of incidental, and everything is happening on campus, and on campus there are very good simulations, and everything is happening on campus. And the fact that they're working is almost beside the point. In other places, you'll see the same apprenticeship being delivered where the trainers and assessors are right in there in the workplace. They're guiding and supporting the supervisors. They're providing resources to help manage the learning experiences. They're encouraging the learning experience from the workplace to be brought back into the classroom and experiences in the classroom to be taken back into the workplace. That's a completely different kind of model. I'm not saying one is better than the other. What I am saying is that each of those will have different implications when it comes to amount of training. And of course, to think about those from a traineeship or an apprenticeship perspective, something that we would need to see thought about and expressed in the training and assessment strategy kind of document. That's what 1.1 is really looking for, is how have you determined the amount of training that is appropriate for these learners. Projects and assignments, where you set activities that are to be done in their own time, or group activities in some occasions because the competency is about a group activity, and assignments. Anything that you set, assessment preparation and assessments. These sorts of things are part of the process of getting from a level of naivety in relation to the competency standards to a level of sophistication in terms of the competencies. So we can think of the whole process for the learner as a kind of journey. They start from that point of naivety, and their task is to achieve the competency thought of as a kind of destination. And your job is to guide them along the path. It might be a simple path where they just go from A to B, straight through, no hassles, and the amount of training is represented, if you like, by the length of that journey. But another person starting at the same point might follow a different mode of instruction. And so for them, the path may be a different length. It may be somehow or other shorter. I don't know how I can express that geometrically. Or it may be longer, which is sort of illustrated there. Or they may have some ground to make up, such as language, literacy and numeracy issues. So they may be starting further back, and for them the amount of training will be more. Others will already be part of the way there, and for them a fast track will be involved. So a person starting at C only has to go a little journey, and you would provide for them a lesser amount of training. They would need a lesser amount of training. And finally, a person with RPL possibly doesn't need any instruction. I'll use the word instruction there as distinct from training. They don't need to attend class, but they'll still need to acquire an understanding of the kind of standards that they are needing to demonstrate within an RPL context. They may need to get some sort of contextual understanding of the language that is involved, because when they come to do assessments, they need to know what it is they need to demonstrate. So that's not learning free when it comes to RPL. What you're recognising is prior learning, but that doesn't mean that there's no further engagement for them within the context of the RPL process at all. So I'd like to ask you now to give some thought to what might be involved as an amount of training with a real example. In your materials, you'll find a copy of the unit Participate in Workplace Health and Safety. What I'd like to do, ask tables to do, is to take out the thought activity 3. And if you look at activity 3, what I'm asking you to do is to speculate. And it's only speculation here. No one is going to hold you to these numbers. On the sort of learning activities a typical learner might be involved in to achieve this unit of competency, the sort of amount of training that a language literacy and numeracy challenged learner might be engaged in, and the sort of amount of activities, learning activities and amount of training that a person with RPL, an RPL candidate, might need to be engaged in. And I've given you an example. For example, the typical learner might need about 3 hours of preliminary reading. Would it be reasonable to say that a person who is language literacy and numeracy challenged would also take 3 hours on preliminary reading? No. Okay, so we should really amend that 3. He says, pretending that he deliberately made this error. And we might make that 6. We might say, well, if they're going to need to put more time in on the preliminary reading, and it's only fair for us to make it clear that this is for you, it's going to take a longer time. What about the RPL candidate? Will they need preliminary reading? Well, they might, because you might want them to become acquainted with the way you think and work so that they're ready for assessment. Well, they might not, so that the 3 might stand. Or it might become a 0, because you might be saying, well, I'm not going to ask you to do any preliminary reading. We're going to hop straight into the assessment. So each of these examples that I've given you there actually probably need some further thought. But that's what I'm asking you to do in your groups. How are we going for time? How much time have I got left? 45. Oh, I'm luxuriating here. So what I will do is give you 15 minutes or so now to give some thought to the unit of competency and to the kinds of learning activities. And then if you could assign numbers to those learning activities, that would be an indication of the sort of hours that a typical learner, a person who is language literacy and numeracy challenged, and a person who is going through RPL would need to engage in those processes. But before we do, are there questions that people would like to ask?
I just thought that in my experience in a nursing healthcare component that I teach and have experienced, a lot of the extended time in training is undoing what they've learned as bad practice. I've spent a lot of time unmaking the bed, so to speak.
Yes.
And a lot of the what you said is quite true, but I think just asking if you agree that your flexibility on the hours and content and the planning of your training is undoing bad practice. And they come with a set idea that that's the way to do it. I've learned it that way and it must be right. And I say, I'm afraid, to comply with what's expected of you and the standards in your work practice, you have to start again and undo it.
And again, what you're demonstrating and illustrating here is the thought, exactly the kind of thinking that we're interested in, because you've understood your clients come not so much with a lack, but a misdirection, and you have to redirect them so that they can cope with the requirements of the standards as they are now and as you're presenting them. And so that certainly does become part of the amount of training, because it's a reflection of the cohort of people that you're dealing with. And it is certainly true that there are circumstances where trained people are often harder to teach than untrained people, that you first have to wipe the board clean before you can write the new ideas on it. And that does become part of the amount of training for that cohort. So you might in your training and assessment strategy say, for people who have undergone previous and now outdated training, we need first delete, but I'm sure there's a better word. but we need to enable them to set that aside and adjust to the new requirements. So that will certainly become part of the amount of training. Now, whether that is done through your active involvement, or whether you provided them with pre-reading and activities or thought activities where they reflect on what they've done in the past. I remember as a driver that when I did some advanced driver training, which doesn't show these days, I'm afraid, but when I did this, the instructor said I had to verbalise everything I was doing because all my activities as a driver were automatic. And I wasn't thinking about what I was doing. But by articulating what I was doing, I brought it back to a level of consciousness where I could then change it. And I think that's one of the problems, is you get people who are vastly experienced, and they're so experienced they don't know how or why they do anything. And it makes them very difficult to train and to redirect and to instruct against the new requirements or the current requirements, because these things are not only ingrained but are sort of subliminal. So to get that back up out again so that they can then face the kinds of quaint things that they do and then change is part of the amount of training. And understanding that and acknowledging that of that particular kind of cohort is part of the thinking that we really do need to see. I might say that after this, and I'm foreshadowing where we're going, it is important to understand that when you have specified the amount of training, what you're doing in a sense, like any training and assessment strategy, is saying, I'm ready to run with this. I'm ready to go. I've got the resources. I've got the staff. I've got the assessment tools and so on. It does not lock you down, because you may discover when that group of people is in front of you that in fact they need more or they need less. So we would expect the amount of training to change. As auditors, we might see at an initial audit, we may see that this is the amount of training that you proposed. And then at a follow-up audit, we might discover that you changed that because you discovered that things weren't exactly as you thought, or there was a new way of dealing with this, or the people were carrying with them expectations and understandings that you had to unravel. Under those circumstances, we'd be thrilled to see that you had been flexible and thoughtful and modified your expectations and requirements. So none of this writing that you might be doing now is locking you down. What it's trying to do is to expand your thinking, understand that first of all that all of these, there are a lot of activities that you can ask of a person to achieve a unit of competency, that each of these activities has a commitment component to it, that an engagement component to it that you need to communicate to the learner and build into your planning, and that different learners will have different kinds of requirements in terms of engagement, and therefore you need to think about the amounts of training that are involved. So I would like you to try that thinking with a real unit of competency. So it's this one on participate in workplace health and safety. It's one a unit I think you're going to be using later on today in another session. So it's worth sort of embedding yourself in it a bit because you'll be picking up and preparing for a later session. In that sense, this is part of their amount of training. And give some thought, first of all, to the learning activities that you might prescribe. Notice that they have to be prescribed and assessment activities, and then estimate times. And we'd be interested in talking with you when you've had 15 minutes or so to look at that, about the kinds of challenges you had in formulating these ideas and the kinds of variations that you thought would work in dealing with these different kinds of learners. Does everybody feel comfortable about what to do? Brilliant. Let's go for it. We'll wander around and see how you're going. And I must say that I'm impressed by the kind of thinking that people are putting in, and that's exactly what we're thinking about. No auditor is going to say to you, you've put down 80 hours and I think it should be 81. That's just not going to happen. And the point about it is that we might say to you, well, why do you think 80 is reasonable? What sort of variation from that would be appropriate for a particular person with a particular kind of challenge or opportunity? So it's the kind of thinking, and at every table that I've been to, I've been hearing the kind of thinking. Even to, if I may say, to one table that said, we don't think we can answer that question because we don't know what the learner is like. But once we know what the learner is like and what the sort of challenges they're facing are, then we could respond. And an auditor could legitimately say, well, what sort of responses might you make? And one response might be, oh, well, we'll tell the learner to go somewhere else. Because we don't have the resources to cater for that particular kind of issue. And that's a legitimate response. We would probably want to say then, well, you need to make that clear in your marketing materials that, you know, that there are boundaries to what you can do. But we would want to be able to see that you weren't making a promise. In the context of reasonable adjustment, which is does relate to both training and assessment, there is a notion that a person with a defined disability, as distinct from a learning language literacy numeracy issue, you need to form a kind of contract which says when you get to a unit of competency where you'll be challenged in relation to this disability, then we will commit the resources to being able to provide it, cope with it, or we won't. I mean, and it has to be in writing. We're not suggesting it has to be in writing. But what we are saying is it has to be thought about so that the person isn't brought in, doesn't engage in the learning process under some sort of false pretenses. So by saying, well, if we face that kind of challenge with this kind of resource, it's legitimate for the auditor to say, where's that resource coming from? How will you access that resource? When will you apply that resource? Because what we want to be able to see, and this is part of Standard 5, where you talk about your responsibilities and commitments to meeting the requirements as well as the student's responsibilities and commitments. We would want to be able to see that you as an RTO had not only thought about the issues but had planned to respond to those in a way which would enable, as Standard 1 says, enable the learner to achieve the outcomes. So we've got 13 tables in the room and I think that's a bit too many to try to sort of go table by table. So what I'd like to do is to ask for volunteers to comment on the challenges of this task to what extent was the task useful? Now, in other words, what did you find difficult and what have you found constructive out of giving this kind of thought to this task? Who would like to... here we have a volunteer. The check is in the mail.
Ours is quite unique because we are 100% Aboriginal cohort completely. That is a compliance of the training package. We deliver the certificate in 3 and 4 at the moment in Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander healthcare and practice. So this unit is one that we deliver in conjunction with a few others. And I started to say to Michaela before that the challenge really for our cohort is to actually know what a piece of paper actually looks like. And I say that without too much jest, but realistically when we say policy and procedure and workplace procedures, they just nod. Mm. Because they're used to the tactile work that they do. Many of them have not actually gone into a workplace before. Most of them have language literacy and numeracy severe problems. Mm. But our whole of organisation says that we must educate the people in our region. And so we're saying, okay, it's difficult for us not to bring them into the classroom, but they're really not ready for Certificate 3. So something like this, which is pretty full on, we blend with infection control and we blend with privacy and confidentiality units as well. This is a very full-on unit, but the most part that takes up here is face-to-face and actually introducing them to what a policy and procedure will do to them. Hmm. So we're quite unique and different, and getting them used to using a risk or hazard control a template, for instance, is easy getting them to do the journey of that. We take them out around our buildings, et cetera, to do that. But actually getting them to fill that out takes a very long time. So that's quite different for us. And the assessments have to be completely adjusted. Lots of it is verbalised and they have a lot of open book. So we have to stress that out through the whole training time.
I think this is a lovely illustration of the fact that, technically speaking, we're not talking about reasonable adjustment here because being Indigenous is not a defined disability. But nonetheless, we can learn a lot from the concept of reasonable adjustment, which is to say, what we need to do is to be flexible in our delivery processes. We need to interpret the standard in such a way as that it doesn't shift in terms of its credibility and its meaningfulness within the context of industry and its ultimate application. But we are not constrained by a particular way of delivery and we're not constrained by a particular way of assessment. We are constrained in terms of the outcome, but we're not constrained about the pathways that get people to that outcome. And that does mean that amounts of training in this particular context will be substantially more. And it'd be substantially more challenging because one has to be sympathetic to both the prior experiences of the group and also the cultural and other dimensions that come to play. I have to say that not in this particular case, I suspect, but there may well be circumstances where no amount of training is going to get this particular cohort of people to a point of competence. In which case you have to say, well, look, this is not the competency that is appropriate to this cohort. And others just requires a good deal more ingenuity and maybe a good deal more investment and a good deal more support and coaching and mentoring and the like to get people to that point. In other words, that's that person who's got a way to go before they even reach the starting line. and you may have a lot of preparatory work that's involved. That all becomes part of the amount of training, but it's exactly that kind of thinking that is the power of this little phrase buried within the standards. Amount of training is both a threat because it's not clear what it is, but a wonderful opportunity because it does ask the question, the sort of questions that you're challenged with there too, are we doing enough, if you like, and are we asking the learner to do enough to get there, to achieve the outcomes. Thank you for that input. That's very valuable. And it does remind us that, we're dealing with a wonderfully diverse group and we don't want the end point to be... I like that comment that, equity... equality means that everybody gets the same, but equity means that everybody achieves the same. And so for everybody to achieve the same, that is equity, you have inequality of input. So to achieve equality, you often have to have inequality because people start unequal. And we want to remedy that. The vet sector has this powerful quality, I think, that we are interested in the standards of outcomes. And we aren't satisfied with the notion that we'll simply provide everybody with the same menu of experiences tolerate the huge diversity of outcomes that we see in other learning environments. Any other comments about the challenges faced, or any comments about the benefits that you see in thinking about this? Hi.
Hi. We actually started with the end in mind, so we started with the performance and the knowledge, and worked our ways backward from there. One thing that we got a little bit stuck on, which created a decent amount of discussion, was which AQF level to actually pitch it at. This particular unit is covered within 47 qualifications, ranging from Cert 1 to Cert 4.
Mm.
So the amount of training and assessment linked to that AQF level got us a little bit, created a bit of discussion, and we'd love some feedback on a better way to actually approach that.
I'd love to be able to give you that feedback. Others might like to share their views, but there was a time, of course, when units did have AQF levels associated with them, and I mourn the loss of that, because the understanding then was that a unit, which is a fixed point in space, doesn't go up and down depending on the nature of the people doing the course. It represents what industry expects, and that is a defined point. And so if you happen to be in a higher level qualification, you'll find that a unit easy to achieve. If you're in a lower one, it might be more of a challenge. But the point of outcome is fixed. I still think that's true. But the fact that the code that gave us the AQF level was missing means that an aspect of the complexity and the sophistication of the unit is not being communicated to you now in the new so-called streamlined standards. It's a bit of streamlining, which meant a little loss of information that we really found valuable. I would still argue that the unit still is fixed in place, and if it is a part of a Certificate 1 qualification, it's probably a Certificate 1 unit. And you can look at the language of it, and it talks, I think, about under guidance. The person's not, in fact, managing the processes, but are, in fact, participating in the processes. And participation is about level 1, it's AQF 1 or 2, probably AQF 1. In which case, that's the level which you would pitch it. And someone doing it as part of an AQF 4 qualification will need less amount of training, probably because they will have had more experience and because they may be more proficient learners than a person who is doing it at AQF level 1. They are coming in very naive and may even struggle, as you've said, with the concept of something written down on paper. So the amount of training will depend on the outcome won't depend on the level of the student, but the amount of training you put in will vary according to the level of sophistication of your client group. So you can see that as an auditor, I might have an opinion, but what I'm more interested in is your opinion and how you arrived at it, and have you has as a consequence of your thinking, you come to a decision which will lead to credible outcomes. And that's what I'm hearing. That's what I saw when I walked around the room, which was really good to see. The amount of training is not set in stone. It's not set in stone in an auditor's mind, and certainly must not be set in stone in your mind. You'll almost certainly adjust the amount of training once you know the cohort of learners. And I mean, it was useful to have a list of participants provided, or questions from participants for today, because it gave me a sort of sense of, well, you know, you were already well thinking meaningfully about the amount of training even before you came here today, which was enormously encouraging for me, and it enabled me to adjust a little bit about the amount of training that I needed, well, the nature and mode of training that I was going to use here today. So adjustment is not just necessary, but it's a clear indicator that you as trainers and assessors and as RTOs generally are responsive to the needs of your learners. And that's very much what the standards are about. And of course, you may also vary the amount of training when you adjust modes and new resources come available, strategies. As a result of course evaluation, assessment validation and industry feedback. So, we would expect under Standard 2, where you are looking into appraising the quality of the work that you're doing, it will have let you know quite quickly as to whether or not the amount of training you're providing is sufficient, as is required in Standard 1, whether or not there are strategies that you could adopt to achieve greater proficiency. I think it's important, though, and it doesn't say this in the standards specifically, I need to stress this, but it's important that you've gone to the trouble to give this sort of thought to the amount of training, then why not communicate it to learners, because it'll be useful for them and employers, particularly in an apprenticeship or traineeship context, to trainers and assessors, of course, through the TAS and for that matter, to auditors. It's a useful idea to communicate. Because then, as we said before, learners can make realistic assessments and appraisals of what they what is expected of them. So you could include information about the amount of training. It's not necessarily in the same format as a training and assessment strategy document, but in an appropriate way, in brochures, it could be in narrative form. You could be saying this is a major course you're undertaking. It will require a lot of your time. We would expect you to be able to put 40 hours a week aside for this, something of that kind. Or it could be quite explicit in terms of the amount of time you expect in relation to components. Do you need to spell out all the components? Well, you can if you want to. You might say this much time on assessment, this much time on structured unsupervised activities, this much time on supervised activities and contact. What do you think the learners need to know? When you've reflected on that, then provide them with that information. You've put the thought in, all you're doing is communicating it to them. So in brochures, unit delivery and assessment plans, course delivery and assessment strategy documents. And an auditor will want to see that sort of information and that sort of thinking. So an auditor will want to see how you determined a credible amount of training and how you estimated variations. So you might say, well, I couldn't estimate these variations in detail, but these are the sorts of things. When it's that kind of narrative, it may be something written down, it may be in tabular form of the kind that we were looking at in the activity, but it may be just a conversation that we have with you, but we want to see that you arrived at a reasonable, credible decision about the amount of training that's needed. The auditor will also want to see how you've adjusted the amount of training in response to feedback, because that's an expectation under Standard 2, that feedback is used to systematically improve the quality of your training, planning and delivery. And finally, we want to see how you've informed participants. Standard 5 says that the learners need to be told by the RTO about their responsibilities and the level of engagement and the like. So we, as auditors, will want to see how you've thought about it, how you've modified your thinking over time, and how you've communicated your thoughts. And in doing so for the auditor, you're also doing it ultimately in a way which will communicate with others as well. So it's a good thing to practice. I hope that today we've had a good chance to look at the amount of training. I'm happy during the break to talk with any of you at any time anyway, I mean now or in the future, about this issue. If you do have further questions or issues about the amount of training, then I hope that there's an opportunity for you to put those questions in writing in your feedback, because this is not necessarily the end of the process. We are meeting again, not us, but some of us are meeting again on Monday, so any feedback you provide will be helpful to improve our session and make the amount of training we give a more better targeted next time. Thank you.